I'm Rick Emerson, and on today's Outlook Portland, we talk about food, restaurant enthusiasts, and the impact of the economy on Portland's culinary culture. And we do it without using the word foodies. That's today on Outlook Portland. I'm Rick Emerson, and welcome to Outlook Portland on Portland CW. It was Howard Beale who said, "I don't have to tell you times are bad. Everybody knows times are bad." It was the book of Deuteronomy that said, "Man cannot live by bread alone." It was Mr. T that said, "A brother gotta eat." So with all of these three things in mind, we now welcome Kelly Clarke, who is arts and culture editor for Willamette Week, to discuss the issue of Portland's economy, its continued effect on restaurants, restaurateurs, and restaurant patrons. We will also discuss your pocketbook and how it ties in with the unique offerings and vibrancy of our fair city. Just so we can get the seething resentment and envy of the audience out of the way, Kelly Clarke, is it fair to say that you are, in fact, paid to eat?
Absolutely, as my scale will tell you.
Fantastic. What would you be doing if you were not writing for Willamette Week?
I'd probably be stuffing my face with something and not getting paid for it, or I'd be gift wrapping presents right now because, you know, that's what I do for fun.
Okay, then, just for no readily apparent reason?
Just to mess with you, probably.
To what extent is the current fiscal kerfuffle?
Kerfuffle, that's a new one.
I was going to say brouhaha, and then I thought about imbroglio, but
well, that would just be silly.
Kerfuffle is an underused word, and I feel like it never really gets its due.
Okay.
So to what extent is it, do you think, impacting the way that people are spending their entertainment dollar or their food dollar? Because you always hear that, well, people are, you know, they're cutting back, they're trying to be more frugal. And then I read somewhere the other day that American movie attendance, first-run movie theater attendance, is up something like 18%, which seems impossible, but if it's true, it's not impossible, it's just insane.
It's a little crazy. I mean, I have noticed that beer theaters around town, the second-run theaters for $3, like at Laurelhurst Theater, where you can get a slice of pizza and a beer and go see a movie all in the same place, those places are having a lot of business. So I think that's more in line with what's going on right now. You're trying to get more bang for your buck, you're trying to fit a whole bunch of different things together, and that's working out well for restaurants here in town. People are not going out to eat as much at high-end restaurants, but they're eating happy hour at those same high-end restaurants. For instance, on 23rd and Hoyt, they have a great happy hour menu where you can get stuff for $2 or $3. You can get a burger with fries for $4. People might not be eating a full dinner there, but they're definitely going to go for the burger at happy hour.
Really is just one of the most American inventions of all time. It is just
a glorious
thing.
I really think our workday has to respond and let us all, you know, go home at 3 p.m. I think, you know, instead of a furlough day, you just have furlough hour. Everybody leaves at 3, everybody goes and eats at happy hour, and everybody goes to sleep by, you know, 8.
All we need now
is makes more sense.
Woody Guthrie to write a song about that, and then we can all go stand outside and in a circle
like that.
Around the man's headquarters and demand a furlough for the boozing hour.
The booze furlough?
Rick Emerson is wholly in favor of all these things, but he doesn't speak on behalf of anybody here at the CW. I have no idea what I was going to ask you next, but we'll...
After booze furlough, where do you go from there?
We'll skip ahead to, incidentally, the fact that you said that, speaking of the so-called beer theater, which is like the Laurelhurst and the Baghdad, and was it you that, we were talking earlier, and said you hadn't seen Frost Nixon, you were going to wait and see Frost Nixon in a beer theater?
Yes, you chastised me for this, but it's true. You know, right now, I would rather be able to see something still on a big screen and be around a lot of people instead of, you know, watching it at Netflix at home, but I don't want to pay full price for it. And so what's really great that's happening is that Cinema 21 just announced that they are going to start serving beer and wine at all their shows after 6 p.m., which basically essentially turns them into a first-run beer theater, which is pretty great. So there's a lot of places where you can basically eat and drink your fill while feeding your eyes as well.
There really is something to be said for the idea that there ought to be, I can't even take credit for this, it's my wife's idea, that there should be some sort of mutual fund that just invests you in just sin and vices of all varieties.
Oh, absolutely.
Just there are just amusements and diversions. So there ought to be some mutual fund that just puts you into like whiskey and cigarettes and movies and
if
like
Portland could
Xbox
add a strip
futures.
Club into that, I think that it would probably be the most successful business in town.
Seriously, I would invest in that wholeheartedly. I mean, without even reviewing the portfolio, I'd put my entire
life savings
to put everything on the line for that. So there's all of the happy hour stuff that is springing up, and we talked the last time you were on the program about food carts and how they're there to serve this sort of middle ground that is probably not exclusive to Portland, but does seem very prevalent in Portland, mm-hmm. where it's not low-end food, it's not high-end food, It's somewhere in the middle, and the low overhead of having a food cart means that they can offer really a lot of stuff for not a lot.
Absolutely. One of the carts that we've talked about a lot is Potato Champion, which is the best cart ever. I mean, they serve Belgian frites, they serve fries in huge cones with lots of different dipping sauces, and they serve poutine with the fries with the gravy and the cheese curds. And that's kind of the best way to explain the carts in town. It's not what other people derogatory, they call roach coaches. It's not like that. It's people who are in love with one tiny little segment of food, and they want to devote themselves to it by doing it in a cart, and as you said, with low overhead. And so they've become even more popular as money's tighter, because you can usually get more food on a smaller budget. You're running around, you're doing a lot of you're doing a lot of errands, and it's a great way to just get something tasty to eat at a low price, and there's great ones all over town.
Actually, speaking of Potato Champion, my wife and I stood in that sort of parking lot asphalt area where they're located. Mm-hmm. There's a whole circle of those carts. And we stood there the other night at around 1:30 in the morning, because we've been out doing something or other, and we stopped by and like the fistful of fries for however much it is, and it was really just, and it was fantastic. And really, without sounding too cheesy about it, it was kind of a great communal experience as well, because it was chilly outside, but they have those weird light,
the crazy,
yeah, those huge Coleman heater things that are on stilts or whatever, and that kind of goes and just puts the heat down at everybody, and so we're all sort of gathered around it like moths to a flame, and standing there clutching our deep fried potatoes and bonding in 2 a.m. Portland style. And it really was something exceptional, and something that didn't exist even a few years ago really on this level.
No, there's really been a dearth of late night eating. And so, especially the pod cart you're talking about, pod cart, that's something totally new.
The cart pod. Grandmother there. I don't
Here's
know,
my
you kids,
pod cart.
You love downloading these pod cart
exactly.
things.
It's the pod of carts over on 12th and Southeast Hawthorne Boulevard that you're talking
right.
about. That's really kind of a late night destination now, because the city really doesn't have a lot of late night restaurants otherwise.
So that's a niche that I think has been underserved for a long time. What other food niches, if anything, do you see being underserved in the Portland area?
That's actually the big one. The big one is definitely late night, which a new restaurant is going to be opening soon up on 30th and Killingsworth called Fats. Micah Camden, who owns Yakuza up there, he also owns Beast up there, he also owns DOC, he's kind of taking over the entire neighborhood like a jolly overlord or something. He's opening a cheap place called Fats that's in the next month that is going to be breakfast, noon, and night, all breakfast foods. So you can get candied bacon, bacon with the praline on it. You can get French toast. You can get tater tot poutine, all sorts of crazy stuff. And he's doing it at a pretty low price point. He owns a restaurant called Yakuza.
It's just
unnerving. And one called Beast. So I wouldn't mess with this guy. If he's going to name something Fats, let him name something Fats.
A restaurant just called Kill Ya.
Yeah, exactly.
When we return, I swear to you, this is what it says in the paper. Amazing things to put in your mouth for $7 or less.
Yes.
That's when Outlook Portland returns right here on Portland CW.